Hey everyone, it is now time for the review of Neptunia x Senran Kagura Ninja Wars. And just letting everyone know before we begin, there will be spoilers as I'm going to talk about certain details of the game. But if you don't want spoilers, but you still want to know if you should buy the game or not, my overall thoughts, this was very fun as a Neptunia game. But if you are a Senran Kagura fan in any way, shape, or form, there probably will be parts of the game that you are disappointed with. And it wasn't as good of a crossover game. So if you are a Neptunia fan, I would definitely recommend it, but on sale. If you're a Senran Kagura fan, I don't know. I haven't played the series, but definitely there will be parts that you are disappointed with. So with that in mind, I'm gonna start the actual review now, and I'm gonna do it in the perspective of if it's a Neptunia style game. Because there are plenty of reviews out on the game already, and I feel like just looking at it as in, you know, comparing it to the other Neptunia games, because it really did feel like one, I think that'll be more interesting for this review. So, with that being said, let us begin. And I first want to talk about the gameplay. The gameplay, to me, out of all the spin-offs that we've had the best combat, and that's probably from the Senran Kagura influence. Man, was this a treat to go through the levels. And when I say all the spin-offs, I'm including like U-Action Unleashed, Mega Tag Mansion, Cyber Dimension. While they were fun, don't get me wrong, this one just felt a lot more polished. For one, the Neptunia cast looked amazing. Like the designs, compared to like Cyber Dimension where the CPUs just looked like they all had an angelic theme, this one, they had themes that you could tell their old outfits inspired it, but they looked cool. They looked like ninjas. Not to mention their weapon choice. My personal favorite was the dual katana that Vert was wielding. That was wow. But Neptune had her sword. Noir had scythe. Blonde had a spear. And they all worked. The moveset was fun. And even just moving around. Like, perhaps it's because the games normally don't look as great. But just watching the characters move around, it was fun. At least for me. And it gave me that feeling of if I was playing new characters and old characters at the same time. Kind of similar to the next forms. Then we have the Senran Kagura cast. Which, again, this is a part where if you're a Senran Kagura fan, you probably would have been disappointed. Because a big portion of the game is the dress break function. That is not in this game. But as somebody who had never played with it and was trying out the characters for the first time, I could clearly tell there was a difference between the Senran Kagura cast and the Neptunia cast. Not just on their battle style, which some like Homura and Miyabi, it's like, whoa. You trying to be my favorite characters with those sword plays? But then you also had the money shots, I suppose, that you would be exposed to as you were using the characters. And that certainly left an impression. It got to the point where I was like, the CPUs, you know, if I want to focus and if I want to have, you know, an interesting time, then I use Senran Kagura cast. And finally, we feature two new characters, Yuki and Go, which both had very unique combat styles. Yuki, I think they put the most time into her moveset, just looking at the special alone and the animations. And Go featured like kill shots on each and every one of her moves. So that was cool. So all the characters were fun to use. And then on top of that, we had some very interesting boss battles. I was thinking that they would just be some generic beat 'em up, but they actually had patterns that you had to adapt to, and they were not pushovers unless you include that fact that you could use items, because for me, I tried to make it a challenge by not using items. So yes, using items would probably make the game easier, but for me, personally, it's more fun if you just use the drives, which were a very nice feature. On where you can power up your character in certain different aspects and change the battle to your favor, either with defense, healing, more stamina, or more attack power. And they also change the look of the characters and have some very nice music, which I do also like the music of the game as well. Or you could try changing your weapons, and there were some very powerful shuriken and kunai in the game that can help you in your combat. The maps also surprised me as well, because coming from Neptunia style games, they normally like to repeat maps like crazy, and they also like to repeat their bosses. And while there are a few repeat bosses, it wasn't enough to where I felt it was annoying. And some bosses I actually wanted to fight again because I was like, man, I didn't do so well in the first one. Let me try my hand again and see if I can improve my performance. But all the stages looked unique. Even though some of the themes were similar, there were multiple like forest type themes. They were still different forests. You could tell that you were in a different area and it never felt recycled. Or the ship, for example. There was a point where the ship was fixed and you explored it, and then there was a point where it was broken and you explored it. And it was different parts of the ship as well. So overall, I was really impressed with the gameplay. And finally, there's this fun little mode. I thought it was fun, I guess, to kind of keep some sort of a Senran Kagura influence. The Peaches and Cream, it's a balancing act, and you basically have to try to keep your characters afloat. And if you succeed, you get some status buffs that you can take into battle. And if you fail, well, you could argue that it's not so bad if you fail. I would just say that. But I thought that was a fun little mode to add into the game to help mix things up. But there are three things I want to address when it comes to the gameplay that kind of bring it down a bit. The biggest one, I think, is the missions. The missions are not the greatest. They range from fetch quests to defeating a certain amount of enemies to doing things in a certain amount of time. And while that's cool, it has you revisit the same maps that you've already been through, which already have a motivation for exploring them again because there are little chests that you can miss in the maps that can give you certain items. But going through the maps again and again and again and trying to defeat the enemies, I will admit, I got tired of doing the missions. And it's clear that they were there for padding because the length of the game, at least if you just take the missions, compare it to the actual story, at least if you're just doing the main story missions versus the actual story, is quite small. And with how much you pay for the game, or at least how much I pay for the game, you know, it being new, I expected it to be a certain length, and that seems to be where the missions come into play. Now granted, there is a mode at the end of the game that if you really want to just sink your teeth in and play it, that would be where you go, the Yomi training. But that's post-game content, and as far as I know, there's no story thing that unlocks after doing it, so. But even still, for actually going through the story and, you know, completing it, I would have felt if they had some better stuff in between to pad the time. So yeah, I kind of talked about points 1 and 2 together. The missions for padding the game made things seem more repetitive, and, you know, the gameplay started to get a little stale by just continuing to do those same maps over and over again. And also, if you just do the story missions, then the length of the game is actually quite short compared to the actual story. And you might feel that you're not getting your money's worth for that. And the third thing, which isn't so much a negative for me, but it is something worth addressing, is that there are no transformations in the game. And for both series, actually, transformations are possible. And even though this is a Senran Kagura style, the Neptunia series has done combat like this where they can transform. It's a part of their mechanic and their movesets completely change. While it isn't in the game, it's not such a big deal for me because I had such a fun time playing with the characters normally. I certainly wouldn't want this to be like in every single game, you know, for that to be the case. But one could argue that the part of the reason that they didn't is because the transformations themselves might anger Sony. Who knows? But for me, if the trade-off was so they could focus more on the combat styles of the characters that we actually had, then I think it was a worthwhile trade-off. The transformations weren't something I had to have, but it certainly would have been cool to see. So now let's move on to the story, which this is where I really say, as a Neptunia fan, I loved it so much, but as a Senran Kagura fan, I could see how people would just be so frustrated with it. It's really polarizing to the point where I'm not sure how I can address it. And if I were to separate it, you know, in the good parts and the bad parts, I'd have to re-go over some things. So I think I'm just going to address it as a whole. So let's just start from the beginning. The plot. The plot is simple. The Neptunian Senran Kagura cast are at war, fighting over share energy. and an unknown party comes and starts fighting them to take said Sarah energy away from them for a nefarious purpose, or at least so you think. And right away you can tell that the game is skewed to one series, the Neptunia series. And this is where, as a Neptunia fan, I found myself really enjoying it. You know, I got to see characters like Eastwar show up, which of course then by name alone, IF and Kampa were also in the game. They had nice cameos. You even had Affy Mojas and Steam Max come back, and their role, they were used beautifully, in my opinion. They definitely enhanced the game. They were not just a reference to, you know, let's say, oh, let's just throw these characters back in, you know, they'll enjoy them. No. They were treated with love and care. And I appreciate that. And even their boss battles, which I know we talked about gameplay, but their boss battles in particular, I felt, man, I don't feel like they just phoned in their performance. They actually put some work into making their boss battles interesting, and I really appreciate that. Heck, we even had some gaming references in the form of Yuki and Aru. Because if you didn't pick up on it, which I picked up on it like after the game was over, they're a reference to VR. Aru has the letters V and R in her hair clips, and the Yuki's headband is VR goggles, and then Aru's own abilities can mimic, you know, or kind of give you the idea of what VR does. So I thought that was a very nice addition to the game. Bottom line, the Neptunia reference was heavy. But then that's when we look to the Senran Kagura side, and it's like, okay, where's their love? Not many of their plot points, well, I don't think any of their game's plot points were involved in the story at all, or their mechanics. You didn't even see their daimyo, whereas you saw Yuki and Aru's daimyo. There were no additional characters that showed up in their game, and Go the Crow wasn't a reference to their series. Go the Crow was a reference to one of the companies that actually worked on the game, because there's a character in the game that they worked on named Go the Crow, and you know, it's a direct reference, which is cool for them, but again, that means for the Senran Kagura cast, there's basically nothing else for them. Now, it doesn't mean I did not enjoy them in the story, because I 100% did, and just seeing them in the story alone made me interested how they would act in their actual game, so I guess you could say if the goal was to introduce me to the series, it succeeded in that point. But I think the main goal would be, you know, combining both features of the game at full power and seeing how they interact with each other. Which, to be fair, some of it isn't the game's fault. Well, they had to appease Sony, and I think for the Senran Kagura series in general, that cut out a lot of what they could do. But I do think the tone was exactly what it was supposed to be for this game. It was lighthearted, it was funny, it didn't take itself too seriously until the end, which, you know, is kind of common, but I felt like this was a series that you were supposed to get a good laugh with and see the characters interact. And admittedly, I would have liked to have seen more interactions between the Neptunia and Senran Kagura cast, and not just them. There were chirpers in the game, and I was hoping they would do what they did in Super Dimension Neptunia vs. Sekihara Girls, where they had chirpers of the other characters, so even if they weren't there, you could still get to see them. And they partially did that, but just with the candidates. And the way they did it is they made it seem like they were in the world, but just simply weren't in the story. And I've got mixed feelings on that in particular, because if they had done a couple things different, I think I would have been better. One, if they included Senran Kagura characters in the chirper events as well. If they did that, then I would have been like, okay, then they're trying to show a bunch of the other characters in chirper events. And if they did that, then they could have also maybe included Uzume, Pluto, and Pishia. You know, just chilling in there, or maybe Rei and Nondeath. You know, they could have done a lot of different characters from the two series. Instead, they opted for references, and I think that was cool too, but I think including the candidates in with other references, that's where I scratched my head a bit. Like, for me personally, I would rather them either not be in the game at all, or if you were gonna include them, at least add them in the story, like IF and Kampa. Like, IF and Kampa weren't playable. Like, they could have easily given us the excuse, which I think is the case, that they just couldn't transform yet. And that could have made for some more interactions, especially if they added four more characters of the Senran Kagura cast. But I don't know who they would add and if that would make people more upset because they were saying they're not playable. So it's kind of a tough situation either way. But I can say that what I do wish is that we at least got chirpers of some Senran Kagura members in there. But alas, it was not meant to be. Which, going back to the CPUs, they did an interesting thing in the story where it seemed like some of their normal personalities started really leaking into their CPU forms, Neptune in particular. And I think they did that because in the game, it makes more sense if they were in their CPU forms more often, considering that's, you know, their battle form. So I definitely get why they did it, and I think it was a cool choice. Though I'm not sure if I would like that to continue to be the case, because I do think that they are separate for a reason. You know, that kind of loses the appeal if they are really combined. Though, that just might be me. But definitely for this game, I liked what they did. I definitely liked what they did. And while we're at it, there are other sacrifices that they had to make for the game as well, like I guess certain scenes that would be in each one of the games, they were significantly toned down to the point where I thought the normal scenes actually, normal CGs look better than those CGs, when I'm talking about the bathhouse in particular. It's like, oh yeah, it's cool, but it's more just a way for you to see all the characters. It's not doing anything for me if it's supposed to do that, you know what I mean? So if you're playing the game and you're looking for that kind of stuff, I mean, it's there, but if you're fans of, honestly, either of the series, because there are so many examples that I can show where, at least for the Neptunia series, it was more extreme, you're not going to get it in there. It didn't really detract from the game from me, but I can certainly see how it would detract for other people. But finally, what I want to talk about, and I think is an underrated gem in this game, are the villains. We already talked about how I thought the tone was accurate for this game, but the villains in particular really help sell that, because for a game where you're not supposed to take itself seriously, they weren't some, you know, one-dimensional generic monsters. They weren't villains, you know, that really, really irritated you, you know, to the point where you're like, we gotta defeat them. Which, there are times for those villains, definitely, definitely. But YoGamer and Tetsuka, they worked. They were actually funny to watch, just like the main cast. In fact, I actually did a compilation of just a bunch of YoGamer moments, because that's how funny I thought they were. And for the Neptunia series, I definitely think that's something that they should consider. Because when I think of a lot of their villains, Anonadeath, Copy Paste, Avimoja, Steamax, Brave was cool too, but he wasn't on the funny side. They really do help enhance the game and, I guess, make those parts more digestible. Because with a cast like the Neptunia series, at least the main four, serious style doesn't fit them. The candidates does. And the main four can get serious, but I definitely think knowing when to use that is crucial. And YoGamer and Tetsuko did get serious. In fact, I almost wonder if that plotline would have been better served in an actual mainline game. The idea of what to do after peace is one I would very much like to have been explored. And it have a very nice resolution, but still, for a spinoff game, I feel like they were almost too good and didn't have enough time to have their story fully fleshed out. I'm not sure we're going to be addressing this, but I also wanted to touch briefly on the fact that the game was not dubbed, but it was subbed. And as a fan of the dubbed voice actors, you know, I was kind of disappointed about that. But I understand the reasoning, and for me, it was more of a problem in Virtual Stars than it was in this game. In this game, I actually felt like they used it to its advantage, right? Like, if you had to say that there was a reason, listening to YoGamer in subbed actually made some very comedic moments. But in addition, the Senran Kagura games are actually available. What do I mean by that? So we had a previous spin-off game, Super Dimension Neptunia vs. Sega Heart Girls, and in that game, that was actually the first time Sega Heart Girls were dubbed. But the difference is, you basically can't get any of their content if you live outside of Japan. I mean, you can order it in Japanese, but it's in Japanese. You know, none of their stuff is really translated. And their series that used to be on Crunchyroll got taken off for some reason. I had to do some heavy searching in order to even find it. So you can't even get it quickly through legal means. So I think it wasn't as big of a deal for people who would say, oh, I'm interested in Sega Heart Girls. Let me go into their stuff, and I really can't get into their stuff. So I felt like that was less of a crossover that was trying to get people to see the other series. But with this one, the Senran Kagura series is very easy to get and has been released globally on multiple different systems. There is an anime, admittedly, and I heard that that got dubbed, but people also told me that it wasn't very good. But mainly, if you're going from the anime, from the games, you also probably will be disappointed because you're like, oh, well, if I watch dub, then they have no dub in the game. And the games are what this game was trying to promote. So I definitely think that it was an understandable choice to only say, why bother even dubbing them now? If you're going to play this game and expect them to be dubbed there and you get subbed, it might actually be detrimental. And I'm not even sure if they could. I heard mixed things on that, but I'll leave it at that. Bottom line, though, is that even though the game was in subbed, I did enjoy it. The voice actors, very good, especially Yo Gamer. Yo Gamer's VA stood out. Admittedly, she had lines stand out, but still, I enjoyed it all the same. So overall, my final thoughts on the game, if I had to compare it to the other spinoffs, this is definitely one of the top ones for me, though it's hard to say if I would put it over or under certain other games, because I feel like a lot of the spinoffs had their highs and they had their lows. And that certainly goes for this game. It wasn't perfect, right? But as a Neptunia fan, it certainly made me more hopeful for the future of the series. So if I had to give it a rating, and again, strictly going from a Neptunia person's perspective, I'd give it a 7.8 out of 10. It introduced me to some new characters that I might actually be playing their games in the future. I had a great time with the normal four characters that I've come to know and care for. They had some really cool references. The gameplay was fun. I enjoyed the music. Got some nice cameos. Very interesting villains. And it just came on into an overall package. The only shortcomings were one, which is a big one if you're a fan of the series, they did not treat the Senran Kagura cast the same. When it comes to the gameplay itself, the missions really hurt it. And their treatment of the candidates is questionable. Like I said, there are many different opinions on it, but either way. Like I said in the beginning of the game, I would definitely recommend it if you are a Neptunia fan. Ideally on sale, not because it's a bad game, but just because there's not enough to justify the price, in my opinion. Even if you're somebody like me and you enjoyed the dub cast, I would still check out the game. If it's not for you, you know, because it's only in sub, and I certainly understand, because I love them too, but I would definitely recommend you check it out. So, with that being said, please post your thoughts down in the comments below, and I will see you all next time.